गुड इवनिंग फ्रेंड्स, वी हैव वेरी लर्नेड स्पीकर सीएसीएस मनोज बाठिया. ही नीड्स नो इंट्रोडक्शन बिकॉज ही इज रेगुलर एट आवर इंस्टीट्यूट प्रेमिसेस स्टडी सर्किल वेरियस सेमिनार एंड ही इज ऑल्सो द पास्ट चेयरमैन ऑफ इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ कंपनी सेक्रेटरी ऑफ इंडिया ईस्टर्न रीजन एंड ही ऑल्सो रेगुलरली अपीयर बिफोर सीएलबी आरडी आरओसी. सो प्लीज वेलकम विद अ बिग राउंड ऑफ अप्लॉज.
गुड इवनिंग फ्रेंड्स. Thank you, Ranjit, for your nice introduction. I express my gratitude to the chairman for inviting me to be a speaker on today's topic, that is, revised regulatory framework for non-banking financial companies. We are awaiting the DGM RBI to arrive at any moment. I have been asked to introduce the topic at first, and by that time, if the learned DGM arrives, then he will take over. He will take you through the various regulations that have been framed by the Reserve Bank of India in the recent past, and thereafter, if time still permits and you people have the enthusiasm to tarry further, I shall once again pitch in and try and cover whatever is left over. Friends, last 9 to 12 months, we have seen lot of activity in almost every regulatory front. Whether it be the Companies Act, I think for the last 1.5 years it is keeping us quite busy. Whether it be the Income Tax Department and its overtures, I am sure all of you have been quite busy during the assessment periods. Or whether it be the Reserve Bank of India, the regulations which were framed way back in 1997 and thereafter, rehauled sometime in 2007, have once again been revisited and based on the recommendations of various committees, a totally new regulatory framework has been put in place for non-banking financial companies. I remember the days in 1997 when the CRB stamp happened. That was perhaps 1992, if I am not wrong. That was the first time perhaps when Reserve Bank of India became a very, very active regulator, and the RBI NBFC directions were pronounced for the first time. I remember having told at that time, and I repeat what I said then, that while you have few man-eaters to kill, you have made the entire species distinct. It were few non-banking financial companies which went bad, and the entire species of non-banking financial companies has been made distinct. We may have roughly around 30,000 NBFCs, but unfortunately the manner in which we worked, the kind of regulations that these NBFCs suffered, I am sure most of us would have been happy without the non-banking financial companies registration. Those were the days when maybe there were two or three directions which governed non-banking financial companies, and over a period of time, if you look how the regulatory arena has changed, you will find that not less than 24 directions, guidelines, circulars that have come in, which govern the entire gamut of non-banking financial companies regulations. Just to quickly take you through, what are the possible regulations which I can recall, which govern non-banking financial companies? And I am sure you would be surprised to see that there are so many of them, most of them applicable to almost all non-banking financial companies, and hence their compliance at times may become extremely difficult. The principal business criteria came way back in 1998. NOF requirement, again, 1998 requirement, this also came way back in 1998. The RBI Act provided for the initial threshold, and therefore thereafter in 1998 the threshold was changed. Then you have NBFC deposit taken or holding prudential norms. You have NBFC non-deposit taken prudential norms. You have NBFC's acceptance of public depository directions. You have NBFC's auditor's report directions. You have guidelines for fair practices board. You have KYC guidelines, AML standards, PMLA requirements to be complied with. You have guidelines on corporate governance, specially designed for non-banking financial companies. You have master circular on various returns that are required to be submitted by various NBFCs with Reserve Bank of India. You have a different breed of NBFC carved out from time to time, like the core investment companies. You have totally a different regulatory framework for core investment companies. You have non-banking financial companies which are categorized as microfinance institutions. You have non-banking financial companies which are categorized as factors. You have non-banking financial companies which are into infrastructure, which are known as infrastructure financing companies. Directions, separate directions for them. Even when you want to take over control, or when you want to merge a NBFC with another NBFC, you have a separate circular, a master circular, which says the manner in which you can do that, whose approval you need to enter into such kind of transactions. For fraud, the entire mechanism as to how you would report frauds, how would you monitor frauds, and thereafter, I mean, what mechanism that you need to adopt for minimizing frauds, all put in place in guidelines relating to frauds. What I'm trying to tell you is perhaps, I'm sure, some of us at least would not have gone through all these guidelines at all. And even for an expert to go through each and every guideline, which is applicable to a non-banking financial company, it would become extremely difficult to keep pace with the changes that happened almost on a daily basis. Finally, I mean, two guidelines that affect us in a major way are the prudential norm requirements, the corporate governance requirements in some cases, and then as far as auditors are concerned, the reporting requirements with respect to their audit reports. For active NBFCs, even the requirements relating to acquisition or takeover of control would become very relevant. So as you can see, I on behalf of EIRC of ICAI, I welcome Mr. Seth. And Mr. Seth, I was just introducing the audience to the regulatory framework because I knew that you would join in and thereafter you would take over. So I'll just complete in a minute thereafter. So what I was trying to tell you is that the regulations have traveled a long way. The regulations, when they came way back in 1997 and thereafter changed over a period of time, 2006, 2007, and finally now in 2015, they have traveled a long way and they have grown many fold. From what initially used to be three or four directions only, today we are roughly having more than about 20 odd directions which non-banking financial companies need to comply with. Well, friends, I won't hold you for long. Mr. Seth has really covered the entire gamut of the revised regulatory framework, but I wish RBI was as gentle and as good as Mr. Seth appeared to be.
But some practical problem what we face during the day-to-day life, all the auditors are facing in for giving the information certain formats. If you could kindly look at that, then you will benefit.
Yes, I'll go into that, Leela ji. But two or three issues before that, before I come to those issues. I often wonder that whenever you are drafting a regulation, particularly when you have the entire framework in place for about 4 months before you come out with the actual notification, nothing should be left to interpretation, nothing should be left to combinations of two or three notifications that a person has to keep on searching to decide what is the final piece of legislation that he has to comply with. I looked at Mohit, I looked at myself. He was mentioning that if your company has a public interface, then it has to comply with the conduct of business regulations. I wonder, from where does he read this? Which regulation asks me to do this? These words, public interface, conduct of business regulations, they are defined but not used. It's only in the definition portions that they remain, but the regulation doesn't use them at all. The 15th of November 2014 circular, which said that these are the changes that we intend to bring in, that contained every such thing which he mentioned. But the final notification that came on 27th of March 2015, that doesn't have it. So I was really, well, yes, what is conduct of business regulations? It's only compliance with the Fair Practices Code or KYC guidelines. Even otherwise, whether or not they are contained, even otherwise you have to comply with KYC and Fair Practices Code based on the circular which is even otherwise there. What I'm trying to tell you is that you come out with a comprehensive circular saying that these are the changes that I want, that we want to bring in. That circular is in domain for about 4 months. Either you choose to have something or you choose to discard a part of it, no issues. But then you finally come out with a circular which is complete in all respects. Unfortunately, if what Mr. Seth said is correct, then you will have to read the 27th March 2015 guidelines along with the 15th November 2014 circular, which is only a circular but not a notification. You will have to keep both of it together and then try and understand what these entire guidelines are. This kind of complication is only good for me as a speaker. It's only good for me as a consultant. People come to me for understanding what it is. But certainly for companies which are non-banking financial companies, it's an unnecessary hassle to learn 10 different regulations and try and understand what the actual meaning of the regulation is. I for the dearth of time, I may not be taking you through each and every clause of the revised regulations and tell you what was there in the November circular and what is missing or what is added in 2015 notification. But yes, there are certain issues which I certainly want to highlight. The concept of multiple NBFCs are the concept of aggregating NBFCs which fall within one group has been done away with. It was never introduced, in fact. It was only a thought which came in the 15th November 2014 circular. It was a thought that if you happen to be companies within the same group, then perhaps the threshold limit of your determination of systemic importance would be on the basis of all NBFCs within the group taken together and not on the basis of individual NBFCs. Thankfully, Mr. Seth has clarified that it is today only on the basis of standalone NBFC and not on the basis of NBFCs as a whole. But friends, when you look at the 27th March 2015 notification, you will still find a definition which says companies in the same group. What is the use of that definition? The only other place where that definition has been used is to define the tier 1 capital and to say that 10% of your investments or loans made in the companies in the same group, anything in excess of 10% would not be taken into consideration to determine what is the tier 1 capital. It's only for the purposes of perhaps that particular regulation that this definition exists. Otherwise, it's a meaningless addition to the 27th March 2015 guidelines. But then 27th March 2015 guidelines is a major relief to most of the NBFCs that exist. I asked him numbers so that I perhaps the point that I was trying to drive home could have been properly understood. If 500 crores is the net owned fund that you need to have, total assets that you need to have to determine whether you are systemically important or not, then perhaps, as he rightly said, there are only 16 companies in all of eastern regions which will be above that particular limit. But all those NBFCs which are below this threshold limit of 500 crores, and if they don't access public funds, this is very, very important, if they don't access public funds, then there is no prudential norms that they need to comply with. The entire prudential norms doesn't apply to them at all. Then the only other things, maybe the other circulars, fair practices codes, corporate governance circular, maybe those may be applicable to them. The corporate governance will not be applicable to them because it's only for SI NBFCs. But some other circulars in tits and bits may apply to them, but major part of the regulation will not be applicable to them. Now a question which I wanted to ask him but fell short of asking it at this platform is, public funds on which date? Public funds as on 31st March? Public funds during the year? I borrow money and repay it as on 30th of March. Then on 31st of March, I don't have any ICDs. Again on 1st of April, I take back the ICD from the person concerned. Will that tantamount to accessing public funds or not accessing public funds? There are two ways of looking at it. One is I have public funds. When these regulations came in, as a matter of gesture, I don't want to trouble myself with so much of regulations, I repay the public funds, I repay ICDs. The only public funds that our companies will have is ICDs. Nobody is going to lend you money anyways, except for ICDs. The only money our companies would have is ICDs. I repay the ICDs, and I genuinely repay them. I take back the ICDs as capital, I take back the ICDs, maybe in capital formation, but I don't treat them as ICDs. And I don't intend to take any ICD any further. Then, but during the year I have accessed. I don't have any balance as on 31st of March. Will these prudential norms apply to me or will they not apply to me? As an auditor, you will be troubled with this question. And somebody said chartered accountants are fertile brains. We surely are. So fine, as on 31st of March, I remove them. And again, I bring them back on 1st of April. But when you are audited, you are aware that you have public funds. Maybe on 31st of March, you don't have public funds, but at the time of your audit, you have public funds. As an auditor, do I ensure that prudential norms are complied with or not complied with? Going by the spirit of, I mean, this is something I'm sure all of us might face. These are the questions which may come up. Companies have already started asking that what if I return the ICDs back? I don't need ICDs, I'll return them back. In such cases, do I still need to comply with the prudential norms? The answer would be that yes, if you are returning the ICDs and do not intend to take them any further, then perhaps prudential norms will not be applicable to you. But if you are smart enough to return them just before the year-ending date, take them back after the year-ending date, then in those cases, the spirit of the regulation is very, very clear and you will be treated as a company which is accessing public funds and the entire prudential norm regulations will be applicable to you. Friends, a major worry is only the compliance of prudential norms regulations. And then, apart from that, all other worries are with respect to the various disclosures and various schedules that you attach to the balance sheets. As he said, now the disclosures are more, but those disclosures are more only for NDSIs and deposited in NBFCs, not for NDNSI. So in our case, the requirement is not much. The requirement is limited only to those prudential norms which are applicable to non-depositated, non-systemically important NBFCs. Let us quickly have a look as to what are those regulations that we need to comply with. if you happen to be an NBNSI. As I said, concept of multiple NBFCs, no more applicable, it's only on standalone basis. This, what Mr. Seth was telling you, you will have a quick a chart view of what he was saying. I must repeat, these are there in the 2014 circular, but you don't find any reference to them in the 27th March notification. If you have public funds, if you have customer interface, then whether you have to comply with prudential norms, whether you have to comply with conduct of business regulations or not, that is what has been listed out here. Right? As far as 2015 notification, 27th March notification is concerned, I have, though they have used customer interface, though they have set conduct of business regulations, but then they have nowhere in the regulations prescribed as to how this conduct of business regulations or how this customer interface will be looked at. I have not taken them into consideration. I have defined this only on the basis of public funds accessed or not accessed. Right? If you are an NBFC, NBSI, NSI, and if you have accessed public funds, then prudential norms will be applicable to them. But if you have happened to be an NBFC, which is not systematically important and which does not have any public funds, then no prudential norms will be applicable to you. But what is more important is, if you happen to be an NBFC, which is a CIC, and which has an asset size of less than 100 crores, and if such a company, whether or not it has accessed public funds, the prudential norms will not be applicable to it. Because the entire prudential norms are not applicable to CIC. For CIC application, you will have to see the CIC regulation, CIC regulations. However, if you happen to be an NBFC, which is a CIC, which has an asset size of more than 100 crores but less than 500 crores, because beyond 100 crores, you become systemically important CIC. The CIC directions, as was rightly pointed out from the floor, they have not yet been changed. So you become a systemically important CIC. In those cases, if you have accessed public funds, then the entire prudential norms will be applicable to you, to the extent they have been made applicable. However, if you are a systemically important NBFCs, which means more than 500 crores, whether or not you have accessed public funds, the entire prudential norms will be applicable to you. Similarly, for deposit-taking NBFCs or CICs, which are more than 500 crores, the prudential norms will be applicable to them. Majority of the companies that we would be dealing would be companies having an asset size of less than 500 crores. And if you don't have too much of ICDs, then I would suggest returning back the ICD so that the prudential norms hassle is also taken care of. And you don't have to comply with any of the prudential norms that are provided in the 27th March notification.
Made applicable for 31st March 15 onwards or 16 onwards?
As we said, it's applicable from 1st of April 2015.
But he said, I don't know from where did he read this.
The notification says it's immediately applicable. And I would also believe it to be immediately applicable because the 31st March balance sheet has to be prepared. So I would say that yes, it's applicable for 31st March 2015 balance sheet. You may not have now time to return it back. But at least in future you may take care of this. Friends, these are the new definitions compared to the previous prudential norms which have come in. And thankfully, except for definition of leverage ratio and outside liabilities, the other four definitions have nowhere been used in the regulations. They are only in the definition part. They don't find any place in the entire regulations at anywhere. I don't know for what purposes have they been defined.
And this comparison, the group has been defined in, March circular or March notification or not?
Companies in the?
Same group?
Yeah, it's there in the March notification. And as I said, it's used in the tier 1 capital definition. At one place it has been used in the tier 1 capital definition. So these are the definitions. These are the details of those definitions which are used. But except for the outside liabilities and leverage ratio, the others have no application at all. I don't want to take you through companies in the same group. Why I wanted to highlight this was for the purposes of CIC regulations, this become important. 90% of your investments or 90% of your total assets have to be in companies in the group. Then from where do you get the definition of the term group? There they say groups mean as defined in the accounting standards. Accounting standards do not at any place define group in the manner they have been stated here. The actual problem that comes up is, I can tell you out of my practical experience that companies have approached Reserve Bank of India to seek their NOC for merger of CICs, stating that they are three CICs where the entire funds have been put in our own investment of our own company, our own group companies. So allow merger of these, reverse NOCs for merger of these entities. As a normal person, I would understand that if I have got three NBFCs to regulate, all the three happen to be in the same group, all the three happen to be held by the same set of shareholders. If they are wanting to merge, my problem is reducing by three times. And I would be the first one to allow such a merger unless there are serious regulatory concerns with respect to the entire group as a whole. But the matter is now pending for more than 7 months and still no NOC has been received from Reserve Bank of India. Finally, before the last hearing before the court, they have now been made a party in the application and they will perhaps, I don't know what stand they are going to take before the court. It's only for the time to decide, time to tell us. I did not want to comment when he mentioned that maybe within a period of 1 month or 6 months better. But with the simplest of cases, I thought perhaps it was when this matter was referred to me, I thought perhaps it was one of the simplest of cases where NOCs should have been given just for the sake of asking. If that can take more than 7 months, then I don't know what kind of cases are going to get NOCs from Reserve Bank of India in case of mergers and amalgamations. It's really going to be a very, very tough exercise. But there, what issue came up there was the last investment in equity shares of 20% and above. Friends, if you look at the November guidelines, all these four kind of relationships have been defined as being in the same group, these four or five kinds of relationships. And thereafter, it said that for listed companies, investment in equity shares of 20% and above. The regional office's viewpoint was that if you happen to be a listed company, only when your investment in a particular group company is more than 20%, only then you will be treated as a company within the same group, and otherwise you will not be treated as a company within the same group. I hope you are able to understand what I am trying to say. Suppose there is company X, which is an NBFC. There are five listed entities in the group, five listed manufacturing entities in the group. I am holding 15% in one, 25% in another, 10% in third one, and maybe 8, 9, 10% in fourth one. Likewise, the group has seven NBFCs, and each seven NBFC is holding 10%, 20%, whatever be the ratio. Together, these NBFCs control the entire, maybe 70-75% of the capital of those listed entities. And as far as their investment is concerned, their entire investment, their entire assets, 90% of their assets is in this investment only. So when I told them that this company has invested about 10% in, it is a promoter company. It's defined as a promoter in the shareholding pattern filed with the listed with the stock exchanges. So being a promoter company, it is a company falling within the same group. Their written answer was that promoter-promoter relationships we will not see. If you are a company within the same group in case of listed companies, only when you are holding more than 20% you will be taken to be company in the same group. I could not have found any absurd answer than this. Thankfully, I believe Mr. Seth was not there at that relevant time at that particular office. I believe maybe under his stewardship, times, things have changed. Maybe they have changed for better. Maybe now, when you look at the 27th March, whatever definition is there, that's a better definition, and that clearly states that if you are a promoter-promotee, then in case of listed companies, you don't have to look at anything else. Immediately, if you are a promoter-promotee, you happen to be companies in the same group. Right? He has already covered income recognition requirements. No change at all as far as income recognition is concerned, income from investments is concerned, accounting standards are concerned, same as before. If you happen to be any NBFC which is not deposit taken and not systemically important, but which has accessed public funds, then you will have to comply with all these income recognition norms as well. And
so far reversal of income is there.
Yeah.
And you have to reverse the income of that particular year in which the NPA is, in which the particular asset became NPA, or the whole income to say of the earlier years also. I understand this would be only for the year's income, sir. Thank
you. You are talking about if you happen to be, suppose there is an NPA.
An NPA, a particular asset became NPA as of 31st March 2015.
Yeah. And whatever unrealized income is there, that needs to be reversed. Whatever is unrealized. Whatever is unrealized. I think Naresh ji, we did this even in case of banks.
That is what exactly
we did this even in case of banks. Whatever was unrealized, the entire thing is required to be reversed. Right? We said the same thing, only when it is not realized. That is what we have said, only when it is not realized. Right? Income from investments, accounting for investments, we are all aware of these accounting for investments. This has been in existence for last so many years. One of the grossly abused provisions by chartered accountants. Despite knowing that current investments are long-term investments, have to be valued at, long-term is always valued at cost, but current investments are to be valued at lower of cost or rate of value if it's an unquoted investment, or market value if it's a quoted investment. I will not be surprised to see balance sheets where they still continue to be stated only at cost. Previously, before the new schedule came in, that was what was being done repeatedly. And if you don't have balance sheets for 2 years, then the entire cost has to be taken, the entire valuation has to be done at rupee one. I really wonder how many of us really. I have seen cases where investments are made in companies which are now, as per the ROC status, are defunct. If they are defunct companies, then certainly their balance sheets are not being filed. If their balance sheets are not being filed, there is no question of you having their balance sheets for last 2 years. And in spite of that, stating them at cost or stating them at lower of cost or market value is something wrong that we are doing. And we need to be very careful when it comes to accounting for investments. Most of the investments are in unquoted companies only, where rate of value needs to be ascertained, and you will have to state those at lower of cost or rate of value, whatever is.
Okay, value of rupees one has to be taken for the whole lot up to
whole lot, share. Not per share, whole lot.
In a particular company.
Yes. Natural. Again, the adjustment. I mean, it's only strip-wise determination that you need to do, and diminution has to be strip-wise. Category-wise, again, within the category, you cannot set off diminution of one category with appreciation in another category. It has to be provided as a whole, right? This has been in existence for quite many years now, so we are all aware of it. Income recognition, I have already touched upon this. Policy on demand and call loans. I don't know how many NBFCs have this policy. investment policy or demand or policy, all that you need to do is have these policies at least in your board minutes. And then I'm sure none of the NBFCs which we are auditing will have such a policy. So it is necessary that you provide for such a policy, at least a policy on document exists, so that for the purposes of your audit, you can tick mark that yes, you had seen a policy which existed for demand or for loans or for investments even. Asset classification, provisional requirements, he has already touched. Disclosure in balance sheets, whatever provisioning that you have made without netting it from income or value of asset, it has to be shown either as provision for bad and doubtful debts or provision for depreciation in investments. Even otherwise, we are doing that, so that has to be clearly stated. Statutory auditor's certificate is required. Then you have capital adequacy ratio, leverage ratio, loans against security, concentration of credit or investments, furnishing of information, and an NBFC cannot be a partner. All those, except for the leverage ratio, which is a new requirement, all others have existed before. Leverage ratio now is it cannot be more than 7 at any point in time. Outside liabilities to your own funds, that is what is the leverage ratio, and it can be only up to 7 times. Loans against various assets, well, loans against your own shares are prohibited, but loans against gold or loans against shares of other companies, it's only when you are permitted to give loans against shares of only group 1 securities, others are not permitted. NBFCs can give loans only against group 1 securities and not against other shares. But gold, you have a complete set of guidelines that you need to comply with, and the regulations, the prudential norms provide comprehensive guidelines for gold loans that you have to give. Furnishing of information within 1 month of occurrence of any change in complete postal address, names and residential addresses of directors, even if the residential address of director changes, you have an obligation to inform the Reserve Bank of India. Name and official designations of principal officer. If your director himself happens to be the principal officer, then you may designate him as such. Otherwise, if there is anybody else who is the principal officer, then even any change in his designation or address also needs to be provided. Specimen signatures, naturally, if they change, they need to be, if the officers change, then the specimen signatures change, they need to be provided. Partner in non-banking financial company cannot be a partner in a partnership firm. Whether it can be a partner in an LLP or not is a big question. I would say the law is very, very clear here on this, that LLPs are included in the in partnership firms, and even NBFCs cannot be partners in LLPs as well. Even in LLPs, NBFCs cannot be partners. Yeah.
Can an NBFC be a majority shareholder or a promoter for a public company with unlimited liability?
Yeah, I don't see any problem in that.
Because, I mean, if the liability becomes unlimited, the nature almost tends to be similar, right?
Absolutely. But I don't see any problem in that. We have unlimited liability companies floated by NBFCs.
We have
several housing finance companies which have been floated by NBFCs, which are unlimited liability companies.
So what is the rationale behind them not being a partner in a partnership firm, but able to float an unlimited liability company?
Floating of unlimited liability company, again, it's not as common as floating of partnership firms. If you look at the registrar's data, I don't think the entire country will have more than 10 companies with unlimited liability. So, and even those, all those companies with unlimited liability, I can tell you out of my experience, all of them, invariably all of them, are struggling hard and fighting with the department to get themselves converted into companies with unlimited liability. Unfortunately, though the law provides for conversion of unlimited liability into a limited liability company, though the law provides for conversion of companies of any class into company of another class, the rules as of now do not support, and the forms do not support any such conversion. And I can tell you, top companies are still waiting in their wits to get converted into companies with unlimited, with limited liability. Representations have already been made to ministry, and we hope some solution will come out of that. Unlimited liability, again, I don't think it's fancy anymore. He has already covered this as to how changes to keep pace with the Basel norms for banks, how changes in your existing asset classification norms are taking place. So from 12 months you will move over to 3 months, from 6 months you will move over to 3 months over a period of 3 years. Yeah. Guidelines on corporate governance. Initially, these guidelines on corporate governance, they were there in a 2014 January circular, if I am not wrong. And thereafter, these guidelines on corporate governance, they were also provided. Some changes were provided in the 15th November 2014 circular. But then on 10th, but when this 27th March notification came for prudential norms, there was no similar notification for corporate governance. This requirement has come by way of 10th of April notification, and you can see that these are applicable only to NBFCs which are deposit-taking and NBFCs which are systemically important, only to them except which are not deposit-taking but systemically important. So corporate governance norms are not applicable to NBFCs which are not systemically important. And I think only 16 companies, he has said, in Calcutta who need to comply with them. If you have an asset size of 500, I would believe anyways you would be covered by section 177 or 178 of the Companies Act, and even otherwise you will be complying with these requirements. Because previously the requirements of audit committee or nomination committee were not in tune with the Companies Act requirements, but now the 10th April guidelines have synchronized them with the ones with section 177 and 178. But in any case, it's of no relevance to majority of the companies that we would be dealing with. It's only relevant in case of deposit-taking or systemically important NBFCs. Similar is with disclosure and transparency. He was harping too much on disclosure and transparency, but he was only talking about those 16, 17 odd companies which need to fill these disclosures or need to be so transparent. Even rotation is only for these companies and not for all other companies. So don't worry about it. Rotation is only for those 15, 16 odd companies. This is important. This is what we were talking about. This is applicable, unfortunately, to all NBFCs. Whether or not you are deposit taken, whether or not you are systemically important, this is applicable to all NBFCs. Takeover or acquisition of control of any NBFC, merger or amalgamation of NBFC with another entity or another entity with NBFC, merger or amalgamation where such merger or amalgamation would result in acquisition or transfer of ownership of more than 10% of the paid-up capital of NBFC. In such cases, prior written approval of Reserve Bank would be required before approaching the court under Section 391-394. Somebody rightly asked, what would be the status in case of listed companies? If NBFC happens to be a listed company, and if it merges with some other entity, by virtue of which merger, the promoter's shareholding either goes beyond the creep-in acquisition limit or the 25% trigger happens because the new incumbent comes in, whose shareholding in the company will increase beyond 25%. Only in those cases the takeover trigger would happen, not otherwise. The takeover trigger, if your company happens to be a listed NBFC and if you are merchant, several non-listed NBFCs by virtue of which the control of NBFCs would get consolidated and the total shareholding, consolidated shareholding would be beyond 5%, which is the creeping acquisition limit. Even in those cases, the trigger would happen, though the NBFC itself is not involved in the merger or amalgamation. So the point that, I mean, the question that I was trying to understand is, your takeover regulations or your disclosure under the takeover regulations in case of listed NBFCs, if you are merging some other company with the listed NBFCs, the chances are very, very remote that a takeover situation would get triggered. Only when the promoter shareholding would go beyond the creep-in acquisition limit or would go beyond the 25% threshold limit, only then the takeover would get triggered, not otherwise. And if it is the other way around, then NBFC is merging into a listed entity. And if NBFC is merging into a listed entity, and that listed entity issues shares to the shareholders of NBFCs, by virtue of which the shareholding pattern of the listed entity changes, and new shareholders who are holding more than, say, 25% comes in, then the takeover court certainly gets triggered, and in those cases the problem arises. In those cases, approaching Reserve Bank of India before complying with the takeover court is a serious challenge, and I'm sure Reserve Bank of India would take care of such a situation, and they would leave all such mergers to SEBI and for compliance of the takeover regulations rather than sitting tight over their approvals in such cases. It's meaningless that on a same matter where there are comprehensive regulations by other regulator, there is no point for Reserve Bank of India to sit on such mergers and amalgamations. I only hope that in time to come, if at all there is any such situation, Reserve Bank of India would act wisely and grant its permission. Sale of transfer where there is no merger or amalgamation involved, the situation remains as before. You will have to give 30 days notice, public notice, and such notice has to be given jointly. Prior to your commencement of business, there cannot be any change in ownership. The change in ownership can only take after you have commenced NBFC business and not prior to that. Right?
The sale or transfer of shares, is there any limit, I mean, beyond which it, this has to be informed or exclusively in any case? Suppose even 100 shares are transferred out of 10,000.
Only when the transfer results in change in control, only then it is triggered, not otherwise. Even previously, it was not, suppose 10 shares are being transferred. You don't need to approach Reserve Bank of India for its permission for those 10 shares. Only when such a change results in transfer, a change in control, only then you need to approach Reserve Bank of India for it.
And how do you define control?
Control has been defined with reference to the SAS regulations. SEBI acquisition of shares and transfer. Takeover regulations.
Basically, selling of NBFCs. Selling of NBFCs, now it is controlled by us.
Selling of NBFCs? And
transfer of ownership of that NBFC company is now controlled.
No, sale or transfer of shares in NBFC, only when they result in change in control of the NBFC, only in such a situation you need to approach RBI for its permission. That public notice and other things need to
be. There are 10 shell orders. Now all 10 have changed. New 11 to 20 have come.
Which means there is a change in control? So you will have to give a public process. But suppose 10 are there and only one has changed, and that one doesn't have a substantial shareholding in the company, then there is no change in control, though 10% of the shareholders might have changed. Right?
Is applicable to all NBFCs? All NBFCs?
This is applicable to all NBFCs. All NBFCs. Friends, in fact, I must tell you, the last slide which if you can just see, this KYC guidelines, they are applicable to all NBFCs.
We skip that slide, if you can show it, that one.
Yeah.
Just before that thank you slide.
Similarly, this PMLA obligations, these are also applicable to all NBFCs. Fair practices code. Only if your NBFC happens to be in a lending business only then the question of complying with the fair practices code arises. Though it's applicable to all NBFCs, but it's only if you are an NBFC. What is a fair practice code? You will disclose everything to the person whom you are lending money. There will be no hidden covenants in your agreement. There will be total transparency. Whatever is the rate of interest that you are going to charge him, whatever is the penal rate of interest that you are going to charge him, all those are fair practices code, and they are only applicable for lending businesses.
I think some mistake is there in date. Miscellaneous compliances as per Master Circular dated 1st July 2014.
It is. No, as you rightly said, sir, one good thing about Reserve Bank of India is that even if you happen to miss some circulars, then on 1st July of any year, you catch up with those circulars. Every 1st July, Reserve Bank of India compiles all its circulars, all its notification circulars which it has issued in the previous year in the form of a master circular. So it is updated every 1st July. So if you have the 1st July circular, then at least as on 1st July, the circular is fully updated with all the notifications that have come with respect to that previously.
With the KYC
issued
during the financial year, during that
time? Updated, taken into account, circulars which have come during that financial year.
From the beginning or not?
From the beginning.
With the KYC center is also beginning for the ICDs?
I would say yes. ICDs are nothing but loans, I would say, yes. And a person, yeah, it should be. But that's again a major challenge which you need to comply with. I don't think KYC is something. And again, like it's unlike prudential loans, it's applicable to all the NBFCs, whether or not your system is really important. Any other question? Fine, we are already late. Thank you very much.